looks like. I'm Vivek Jagtap. I work with housing.com. I'm available on web with this Twitter handle. How fast is your website? So we have been hearing this from long, right? And you'll keep hearing from a lot of people, like, how faster is your website? And we have been hearing this from long as well. TTFB, time to first byte, then caching, first paint, meaningful paint, and your Google page speed maybe. If it's more than 90, 95, you believe that these all contribute to your high performance web app. And I'm pretty sure you would have reached to this stage if I start talking about performance today. So today we'll see a different way of looking at performance. So before we move on, let's have a look at some myths and misconceptions we have about performance. So first misconception we have is my app loads in x.x seconds. You'll often hear people saying this, oh, my app loads 2 seconds, 3 seconds. So when exactly is the load? How do you capture your page load? Like when your window load event fires, when your document complete event fires, or when your user sees that your page is ready. We'll see that in some time. So other misconception we have is my page loads faster and my users are happy. So how do you know your users are happy? Right? So unfortunately today we have tools and techniques more concerned about first time page load and not the user's entire journey through your app. So you have web page test, you have Lighthouse, all these are more focused on first time page load and not through user's entire journey. That is why reality is your bad user experience can happen anytime and you should know it. So user associate performance with their entire journey and not at the first time. So lots of things happens after your page load. User will click, user will swipe, user will tap on a button, user will keep scrolling things. And in case your app doesn't respond, that's a bad user experience. And unfortunately, bad user experiences sticks with your users most than anything else. So as we see, like, performance and fast, these are vague words. There has to be some metric to measure them. I created an example, just to mimic real world example, where we'll load a map, Google map on a page, and we'll have a button which will open a modal for us. So let's see what happens. Loaded, I can see a button, click, nothing happens, click, nothing happens, yeah? But page loaded pretty faster. There was a lag of almost 4 seconds. Now this is a bit too much, but anything beyond your 100 milliseconds is a lag for a user. And page loaded in around 2 seconds, and in background you can see there are lots of markers we started placing on our map. So these kind of problems can be solved by time to interactivity, which can be tracked via web page test or something or any other tool. But what if these kind of things happens after your page load? Let's say user at e-commerce website, user is scrolling through different items and you have an infinite list and you reach end of the list, you go and fetch next set of data. And at the same time, when your data comes and you're trying to append it to your DOM, your user is busy in clicking some carousel or trying to open on a preview item. User will feel the lag if you extend the limit of 50 ms. So these are the problems we saw so far. Load is an experience and you cannot measure by a single metric. Interactivity is crucial and often overlooked. We do agree to this point. And entire experience matters to your user and not just a faster page load, right? So what we'll see in this talk today? Example of a faster page load, which we saw just now. What are the causes of this bad interactivity? And how do we measure them? So we'll measure them on real users. Now we might be testing in a lab or in-house by putting a slow 3G network or a 2G or something of that sort. We might be getting some numbers, but how many of us really know that how many users are getting a page load more than 4 seconds, 5 seconds or 6 seconds? We have no data for that, right? So we'll put something in our production code which will give us the actual time to interactivity and how much time it, what kind of long task we have throughout user's entire journey. Then once we identify them, we'll see tools and techniques to boost this performance. And the fifth part, which is the scheduling tasks by priority. So what are the main causes of bad interactivity and bad user experiences? So we all know this. So things like this, long running task in your main thread often causes your bad interactivity, right? Things like this. Shorter tasks are always better. So coming back to our example again. Sorry. If you load, nothing happens. So if you open a timeline view, we can see our click event was waiting for this. The main thread was busy in putting all your markers on a map, right? So who are the culprits for these kind of experiences? There are lots of things happens in your user's journey, right? You might be queuing your analytics data when user is browsing your website. And at some point of time, you might try to send them in one go. And it might happen that same time, user is trying to perform some action. So typical example you'll see often is scroll behaviors. Usually you'll see most of the website will have a jank in scroll. That is just because of these kind of things. Like user is scrolling a page and you are busy updating in some other part of DOM or busy in getting some other data or lazy loading certain other things and which are blocking in your main thread. So these are some examples. So how do you measure them on real users? We can measure on web page test or Lighthouse or things of that sort, but how do we measure on real users? So we'll see, we'll put a time to interactivity measurement in our code. And yeah, this time to interactivity will not be based on just your window load or document complete. There are other aspects to it, like with the rise of PWA and server-side rendering apps, what you do is you ship your HTML faster to your user. But shipping HTML faster doesn't mean that your app is performant. What you do is you ship faster, maybe app shell model in a PW, you ship faster, and then you might be busy in getting some other resources for your app. You might be firing 4 events in parallel to get some other JavaScript to load other parts of your page, and user is trying to click on a search box or something, and that same time some data comes and you try updating it. So you don't have a control over all these things. In JavaScript, everything is a main thread. You just wait for function to get executed, right? We'll be measuring input latency for critical events. Things like add to checkout, payment parts, stuff like that. Whichever we feel for our app is critical, we'll try to track them. Whichever goes beyond 50 milliseconds. And this is cool stuff, which is a performance observer coming up in Chrome. Still experimental, but this will tell you what are the long tasks which are getting executed in your app. This is like throughout your journey. You just initialize it when your page loads, and then it's asynchronous, and you don't have to worry about performance of this stuff. Otherwise, you might end up putting a code for performance, which is hampering your performance. So you don't have to worry about this. So we'll see that. So let's start with the time to interactivity on real users. So if you put this piece of code in your application, so there is a polyfill for this. So window time to interactivity cannot be calculated on just window load or document complete. So if you notice here, the function itself says first consistently interactive. Now how do you see first consistently interactive? The example which I told you with PW and all, like you ship app model and then you're busy in getting some other resources for your user. And user sees the search box faster and he clicks, nothing happens. So even if you ship page faster, I mean, it's of no use because your main thread was busy in doing some stuff. So get first consistently interactive thing checks on different parameters. It also internally uses performance observer, which gives a check on long task. Which was the long task which was running in a main thread, then which were the resources you were busy with getting in, and based on that it will give you the TTI value. Now our job is to track numbers, right? So whichever user, this we put it in a production code. So whichever users filling time to interactivity more than, let's say, 3 seconds, we should report to our analytics server. Or 4 seconds, we should report to our analytics server. We'll come to this part, like why we should report to analytics server. So you can see this, you can check this out, time to interactivity polyfill, source code of it, on what parameters it checks on. Then this is the input latency. We, in our example, we saw there was a 4 seconds of lag, right? You clicked on it and it took 4 seconds to open the modal, which is pretty huge. So you can test it with pretty simple example, like you can current time minus your time of event, you get the lag. So if it's going beyond 100 milliseconds, you should be worrying about. Again, report to your analytics server. And performance observer. Now, performance observer has different types. Here we are just putting a long task. So anything which is in the main thread taking more than 50 milliseconds, performance observer will start complaining about it. And again, your job, you'll have some number, right? 100 milliseconds goes, it's a problem for me. So you'll start putting it in a analytics server again. So there are different types. One is a long task. There are some resources which are taking a lot of time to load. You can check this out in a API. Now we saw how do we identify on a real users these performance problems. Now how do we fix them? So there are lots of tools we have in browser APIs which we can utilize. So first is a request idle callback combined with a scheduler. So we created a scheduler for our task and not just relying on a main thread of a JavaScript. So we'll see it in a moment. Request animation frame, we all know. Like for any visual updates, we'll use request animation frame. Then web workers has been there from long, but hardly we use it. Just because they don't have access to DOM, we try to ignore them, but they are really powerful. And the new thing, which is a shared array buffer. Now web workers cannot share the data. Whatever you pass it as a mechanism, as a messaging system. You pass message to a worker. Now with shared array buffer, you can share the data across multiple workers. So scheduler pool, what it is? So we created a scheduler pool. Before I jump onto that, let's see why we created a scheduler pool. This is a pre-scheduler world. So blue is a main thread. And you have task 1, task 2, task 3 to execute. It's a pretty usual way of running your JavaScript, right? You just call function one after the other and it goes on to main thread. So you can see we want to push a new task. We don't have control over new task. We just say run a function. So if you see task 1, we put a task 4 goes to main thread, task 1 gets executed. Now task 4 has to wait for task 2 and 3 to get completed, right? What if I want to put task 4 first before task 2 and 3? So with scheduler, what we did is we created a fast lane for it. Now fast lane is kind of a different queue altogether in which you'll put a new task. So you'll say a priority. So we call it them as a priority queue. So we say, okay, my this function needs to get executed first. So I say this is on priority. So we put it on priority, this gets executed first and then 1, 2 and 3. So our scheduler pool interface looks pretty simple. It just exposes your add job function. So you can use add job, you pass whatever you want to run it as, and you can specify whether it's on priority or not. You can have as many different queues as you want, but as of now we are just maintaining two queues. One is a priority and one is a normal queue. So it checks if your job is on high priority, we'll push them in. We'll make sure that that gets executed first and then your other task. And we are using request idle callback for this purpose. So this is how the code looks like. The do job is a function. This is a main core of our scheduler. It keeps checking, it runs in a request idle callback. And it keeps checking for a deadline. So you get a deadline in a request idle callback, which tells you how long you can execute your task. So we keep checking. If you see, we keep checking timeline, time remaining. We need at least 5 milliseconds to execute something. And if you started, we just pull out priority jobs first. If priority jobs are empty, we pull out the normal jobs. And we run your job for you. So job is pretty generic. It's your function function call. Now what you do inside it is up to you. Whether you make a network call, whether you run some for loop inside it, it's up to you. But one thing to notice here is you are passing a deadline again. Now deadline tells you how long you can execute your job. So let's say you get a 10 milliseconds and you have 500 of items to put it on a map. Now obviously it's not possible. But what you can do is in 10 milliseconds of time, you keep checking for a deadline just like this while loop does. And as long as I have deadline, I'll push how much ever markers I can push on a map. So let's say I end up pushing 30 markers out of 500. Now I left with some 470 markers. What I could do is I can say add two incomplete jobs. This again goes to your priority queue, add incomplete jobs, and unshift your jobs. So when next time browser gets free, your incomplete jobs gets called again. So let's see, just to reiterate on example of a bad pursued user performance, I'll run it again for you. Now this is the use of scheduler. You can see there was 4 seconds, now there is no time lag at all. And markers are also, we are able to place in moment. And page load in just 1.35 seconds. Now we'll just reload this page and I want you to keep eye on this part, console. Let's reload. Click prompt. Markers are also, we are able to place. Now just notice on this number. Right, I can move map around pretty easy. There's no lag at all. So what are these numbers? So these are batches. So if somebody asks you, you want to put 500 markers on a map or thousands of markers on a map, you might come up with a solution of batching things, right? This is a normal way of doing things. Like I cannot put everything in one go, I'll batch it. But when it comes to batching, you'll have a certain number. You'll say, okay, I'll batch it in 50-50 and I'll place them. Now problem with 50-50 batches is that you don't know how long your browser is free. Now with scheduler knows how long your browser is free and keeps telling you, okay, you got this much of time, put how much ever markers you want. So I put 30 markers. So if you notice here, sometimes I put 10, sometimes I put 32, sometimes I put 17. So my batches execute with this approach, and that is where user will not feel lag at all. Cool. Now let's see timeline view of this now. So earlier timeline we saw there was a huge main thread got blocked and click event had to wait. Here we divided into smaller tasks. Now smaller tasks execute faster and click event also gets executed in between, then again we start with this. Yep. This is your click event. So scheduler pool, you can find it code over here. We are using request idle callback underneath it to maintain this pooling. So request idle callback we know. How many of you using it in a production request idle callback? Nice. Just one, two. All right. So request idle callback is nothing but you get some time when your browser is free, and before, just after your frame commit happens in your frame. So yeah, you execute task when your browser is free. React Fiber's mechanism is based on request idle callback. So whatever new reconciliation happens on browser, that is based on request idle callback. So they're strongly using request idle callback for the smaller updates and smartly. So it's very powerful. You can come up with some different pattern altogether, just like we came up with schedule. Request animation frame, we all know, like you get some time frame between layout, before your layout and paint happens. So any visual updates you want to do, like you want to animate scrolling via JavaScript, you can use request animation frame for it. WebWorkers, yeah, WebWorkers are there from long. How many of you are using it extensively, except WebGL? Pratik Bhatnagar did mention yesterday about use of it in his PWA call, talk. Using it for what? Can I get mic over there?
Yeah, so we have a universal React application, and we use web workers as a for PWA. So we use it for a bunch of things, mostly for caching stuff, and also for basic offline functionality.
Yeah, sounds good. Yeah. So I created one simple example where so mostly web workers. The reason people don't use it is you don't get a DOM access to it. So you can just process some data, or you can make a network calls and stuff like that. You can read a file. That is where WebWorkers you will see hardly usable. But WebWorkers are really powerful. You execute your things in a completely different thread. It's like a multi-threading in other languages. It's actual multi-threading. So let's see one example of uploading images. So I'll click. Sorry for this interruption. I uploaded 6 images now, right? Now, this is a, let's see a, in a normal flow how it will look like in a timeline. So, file reader, so for reading files, file reader is again async. So, you can see some differences here. And your function are getting executed in the main thread. The function getting executed main thread, but stuff like this where you are loading of images, so bunch of things are happening here. You don't just read local file, you are reading a file, you are creating an MD5 out of it, you are pushing it on AWS on response, you are again sending it to your server. There are lots of things happening. Doing this in a main thread, let's say there were 6 images in one go. Doing this in a main thread is definitely going to take some time, and user will have to wait. But if you go with worker flow, your main thread is completely free. User can do whatever he want in this time frame, and at the same time, you can see your worker thread was busy in uploading your those 4 images across the network and reading them and creating MD5 out of it. The problem with existing web workers, again, it's not being used, is they work on a simple message mechanism. Like, you cannot share data across web workers. So you pass messages, you can say serialized things over the network, because if you change it in a main thread, it will not reflect in your worker. So that is where you get limitations of it, but they are becoming smarter now with shared array buffer. So this is something new again coming up with shared array buffer. You can actually share data between your main thread and your web workers. So things like Java and programming language have multi-threading mechanism where you share data, and to update some data between threads, you acquire a lock, right? Because you don't want, let's say 2 threads are trying to update the same value. They read same value, 5, 5. And this guy updates 6, this guy also updates 6. But ideally, one thing should happen at one time. That is where you acquire a lock. So same mechanism coming to shared array buffer. So I'll just show you an example where this is how you can create a worker. This is a normal way of creating a worker. We created it with length of 10. And shared array buffer with this much of length. And we have to wrap it with a typed array. You cannot directly use this shared buffer. So we wrap it in an int32 array, and we place some numbers in this array. And then we say to worker, okay, this is it, do some work on it. And this is main thread, and what we are trying to do is, in a set timeout, after let's say 5 seconds, we will try to modify the shared array buffer. okay? And this is our worker file. It's a separate file where we get a message. We again have to wrap it in a typed array because you cannot directly work on a buffered array. And we are just putting a console.log where we'll print first time what we received and after 10 seconds when main thread updates, what is the value. Ideally, we should expect the updated value in this. So this is what it prints. Initially, it receives a zero value, what the main thread passed. Then main thread sets the new value and it gets updated in a worker thread. So this is just example of where the JavaScript is going to. And this also comes with your atomics, which I said, like you acquire a lock before your updation of values and stuff like that. So this is the whole motive of this talk, like whatever happens, don't get into user's way, which comes with the takeaways now. So you should keep eye on your long running task using performance observer, time to interactivity, polyfill, not just window load. Then you should keep track of input latency for your critical events. Second thing is you should reduce long running tasks, break down tasks into smaller chunks and run them by priority. We saw just one example of map where just putting tasks in smaller chunks, how the performance got boosted. Breakup.js, preface them, 50ms is your upper bound, and then use priority pooling like schedulers, request idle callback, animation frames, web workers, shared array buffer. And the last part is pretty important. The whole reason of doing this talk, the whole reason of boosting your performance is this. You should ask these questions. So your performance metrics correlate to your business metrics, right? So you should be asking these questions. Do users with low latency are having a higher drop-off? Or do users who are experiencing lag have a higher drop-off? Based on this data, you can take performance fixes is on higher priority. So this is what I'll leave you up with. I wish you a happy users. Thank you. Keep tweeting on Housing Engineering Twitter handle about cool stuff you do.
Do we have questions? Yep, in the balcony.
Hello? Hello? Yeah. So as far as I understand, the logic about...
Please put the mic closer to your mouth.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
So as far as I understand, hello, the logic about the priority scheduling, it's a part of the event loop itself, is it?
I don't think it's audible. Is it audible?
As far as I understand,
hello,
the logic about the priority scheduling,
hello,
it's a part of the event loop itself.
It's not a part of event
yeah,
loop.
Hold it close to your mouth.
It's
hello?
Not...
Yeah. Okay, now hello. It is.
Yeah, I got your question. Okay. It's not part of your event loop. It's something before you put things into your main thread. So you have two different queues to handle. And the scheduler utilizes your request idle callback. So request idle callbacks tells you that this is a free time. The free time scheduler gets activated and it's holding two queues for you. One is a priority queue and one is a normal queue. The priority queue, it will push tasks and push it into main thread. That is how it is. You cannot get a different thread altogether. For that purpose, you need a worker for it. But as of now, we are just restricting our scheduler to do just one specific job. But yeah, you can extend a different library maybe to push things to a worker and things like that.
How do you do exception handling in this one?
Sorry?
Hello? Here.
Yeah, okay. There, last.
Yeah.
So, I'm not seeing exception handling in your code base there.
Code base?
Yeah.
So scheduler's job is not to handle exceptions. So
if my task actually throws some exception, it will actually break the scheduler, right?
Yeah. That's a good point. I think I never thought about it, but yeah, we can catch around and keep pushing other tasks in queue.
Okay.
Yeah, we have a question there.
Hi. As you said, like the web workers do not have access to DOM. So is it like there? there are certain libraries, like very good search libraries that I came across, which I feel it would be better if, you know, if it can be spawned in the web worker so that it runs in the background, searches some text for me and then give it to the main thread. But those axes basically the navigator object. So is there a way to work around, like the web worker can ignore the DOM part and then just focus on the processing part and give me the search results?
I didn't get your question.
So basically there are some libraries which you makes use of the DOM. Okay. Is there a way to work around it and maybe you can just use it in the web worker?
No, you can't get a DOM access in your web worker because DOM is a tree. And when you pass DOM tree to workers, you are allowing it to mutate the state. Now, the moment you start mutating the state, the browser cannot handle your DOM tree, right? The main core thing of a browser is a DOM. So, workaround is the way we did it is the upload images example I showed you. So, we capture images first and we pass in the URLs to it, that these are the blob URLs. And based on that, then it's worker's job to read that file based on URL. File reader will do. It will upload to server and get some data. And it will send you, it will post a message again back to main thread saying this is the job has been done. Then it's, so it's more of like how do you structure your app. You can't get a DOM access for sure.
More questions? In the balcony again.
Can you hear me? So JavaScript was originally meant to be single threaded. Web workers was quite a recent addition to the single threaded nature of JavaScript. So my question is, in most cases of interactivity, right, you can actually offload a lot of computation to the server. It need not necessarily happen in a web worker or a parallel
right.
thread or a lot of scheduling use cases you talked about.
Yep.
So when do you take this trade-off of, or what are your thoughts on taking the trade-off of pushing a lot of this computation onto the server than, you know, doing a lot of this stuff of parallel tasks and threads and such? And if you can give me some examples of applications which you will prefer doing, you know, more of a worker and scheduling than, you know, using APIs to do a lot of the tasks and then only whichever is specifically the interactive elements you'll push to the client.
So the problem is more on a producer and consumer. When your producer is faster than your consumer, this is where so let's say you have a server which is a producer and your browser your JavaScript is a consumer. When your producer is faster than your consumer, like let's say we can batch those 50 markers via network call. We get a 50 markers, but 50 markers putting is also not, you can't put it in a single go, right? As we saw, like even if you are putting a 50 markers and at the same time something happens, user tries to click. Yeah.
We have a question there.
No, yeah.
If you have seen Google Maps, all those markers that you see, they are only on a focused area. They won't show multiple markers at the same time. It's also to do with the UX perhaps,
yeah.
But you can see that Google doesn't, you know, prefer that sort of a technique.
Yeah. Yeah. So Google also asynchronously loads these markers, but if you're looping around the markers, then you have no clue over main thread, right? I mean, main thread definitely gets blocked. Even you're pushing to show marker to a library, but you're busy in looping around.
Yeah. There.
Hi, Vivek. Good talk. So my question was when you use that while loop to decide which function is to be executed next, can we use a generator there instead, because that looks more like polling if I'm not wrong?
Yeah, you
so,
can.
So we can pause the execution and then set off a different function and then after the time remains it can again.
Yeah, we can think of that.
So is there any benefit that this has over that?
No, this just worked for us. Like as long as we got a free time, we executed those tasks and moved on.
More questions?
Hi. If for some reason my main thread gets blocked, will my worker threads will still work in parallel?
Yeah, it works. It will work.
Will it work?
Yeah.
And if the main thread is back again to the normal execution, it will be able to give pass data to the main thread?
Yeah, so it's a event listener you have, right? In a main thread, when worker when worker says post message, your event listener will get pushed to a main thread's event queue, and whenever your main thread gets free, that listener will get called.
One more question. Is there a way we can create a master thread? Like, I may have multiple threads getting data from a couple of API calls, and in one master thread, I want to collect all the data and then pass it to the main thread.
This is what, this is on a similar line. That's what we are talking about. Like, the scheduler itself have two different queues, and its job is to when to push what on a main thread.
The schedule pool will be able to achieve that.
This side.